It's 9:00 a.m., and we will call the meeting to order. The first item is that we will have Kathy take roll so that we know which commissioners are present.
Commissioner Fisher?
Here.
Commissioner Wardman?
Here.
Commissioner McFarland?
Here.
Commissioner Getz?
Here.
Commissioner Wagner?
Here. The first thing that I would like to do is to welcome our new commissioner, Bob Getz, and we're happy to have you on board with us here. Do you want to share any of your background or any information about who you are?
Well, it's fairly boring stuff, but I'm currently living here in South Dakota. I work for American Bank and Trust. My wife Shelley is in the insurance business. I've got a daughter Rachel that is in PA school right now. She's in Brookings doing rotation there. And then I've got some Rob in Huron that's in the livestock feed manufacturing business. So I'm very pleased to be part of this commission.
Well, welcome aboard. I think you've met all of us this morning that are present. Dennis McFarland from Sioux Falls, he's via Zoom, and Mike Wardman out of Rapid City is also present via Zoom. So hopefully you'll have a chance to meet them soon.
Very good, thank you.
All right. The next thing that we need to do is disclose any conflicts of interest. Do any of the commissioners have anything that would be a conflict of interest regarding the agenda and what we're dealing with today?
We might want to call the roll on that since we've got two via Zoom.
Okay, we'll do a roll call to indicate whether you do or do not have any conflict of interest.
Commissioner Fisher?
No conflict.
Commissioner Wardman?
No conflict.
Commissioner McFarland?
No conflict.
Commissioner Getz?
No conflict.
Commissioner Wagner?
No conflict. Okay, the next item, we will go into our administrative hearings.
Madam Chair, briefly before we get there, I also wanted to, Mike asked that I offer a reminder. The vast majority of the commissioners have completed their annual disclosures. And if you've completed recently a matrix for your conflicts disclosure, please review that. And if you had previously submitted a matrix, review the accuracy of that. We have received the vast majority of those, but if you haven't submitted it yet, please do.
Okay. Did everyone hear that on the commission that you need to complete your conflict of interest paperwork and get that back to Mike Shaw? Okay. I know I have.
I have.
Okay. How about Dennis? Have you?
I don't think I have. I'm not sure I got the form. If I have, maybe I need it again. Who do I get it from, Mike?
We'll resubmit the form to make sure that you have it.
They'll resubmit it.
I'm not getting Mike.
Okay. We'll make sure that Mike knows that, or Doug is sitting in for Mike for this meeting, and he knows that. So Mike Wardman, is yours complete?
I've sent mine in.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Okay. The first administrative hearing regarding David Meddings. This particular hearing will be delayed until December 16th per his request, so we will not be dealing with that hearing today. The second hearing that we will be dealing with is the Charles Johnson appeal of action taken by the commission. That's regarding page 13 through 41, basically are your documents. And at this point in time, I am going to designate Doug Abraham, the counsel for the commission, as the hearing officer. Okay. Good morning.
Good morning. How are you guys?
Good. I'm not sure. Are you going to have him sit there?
Yeah. I'll have you sit over here. Sure.
Sorry. We're still trying to figure all this out.
That's okay.
Oh,
so
And for your information, Charles, I just designated our counsel for the commission, Doug Abraham, as the hearing officer for this. So he's seated there.
All right, this is the time and place scheduled for the contested case involving Charles Johnson. From a background, Mr. Johnson had his license revoked and was placed on the exclusion list, appealed to the Supreme Court. Those documents, including the Supreme Court's decision affirming the commission's action, are in the packet. For purposes of the hearing, it's determined he should be removed from the exclusion list, SBCL 42-70-62. For purposes of the exclusion list, the stamp is received, I believe, August 13, 2020. It was submitted by Mr. Johnson. For purposes of the hearing, the standard of proof, is preponderance of the evidence unless the substantive law provides more stringent standards. The substantive law provides more stringent standards. It's not the situation. The burden of proof is on the individual seeking to be removed from the exclusion list, which is Mr. Johnson in this situation, because the burden of proof is on Mr. Johnson. Mr. Johnson will be afforded the opportunity first to both make an opening statement and present any evidence he has to the commission. So that at this point, Mr. Johnson, if you plan to make an opening statement and submit evidence to the commission, we'd have you support it for the record.
Please raise your right hand. Do you solemnly swear that the testimony you shall give in the matter now hearing is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth that we have?
When you're speaking, you may remove your mask to be heard. Okay.
Yeah, Mr. Johnson, this is the time if you have an opening statement and if you plan on presenting evidence for a witness, you have the opportunity to go both submit documents for order the commission's consideration, call witnesses on your own behalf to make an opening statement and make a testimony statement on your own behalf to the commission. Will offer the floor to you for your opening statement, and then if you want to follow that with offering any exhibits or calling any witnesses on your behalf, that'd be the process for the commission today.
Yeah. Are we ready?
Yeah, you're right. If
I'm not bringing evidence to argue.
I'm sorry, I need to hear you over here, so if you could speak up.
I'm not bringing evidence to argue the case. The case is already said, done. I mishandled the tips. I don't know. I can't argue that I wasn't intentionally deceitful in my actions. I wasn't trying to be dishonest. The only conflict was my statement versus what showed on the video. And I can't argue against that either. I'm just here to argue to try to get my license, get off the exclusion list at least for the future. I've been off of it for 2 years. And it was actually a good thing to be off it for 2 years because I was able to go back to college and learn a few things about the ethics of business because that's what I'm going into. That's all I have to say. I got nothing to argue against the case. The case is set there. I got no evidence to argue against it. I mishandled the chips. I didn't have it better. And I wasn't intentionally trying to be deceitful or dishonest in any of my actions.
You have any
no witnesses, no evidence.
And you understand for purposes of this contested case hearing, you have the opportunity to present any evidence or witnesses to the commission at outside time.
Yep.
Or state you rest for purposes yes. of statements to the commission.
Yep.
So I'll speak. I will attempt to be brief on behalf of the commission. Purposes of an opening statement, I would just waive an opening statement and go directly into evidence. I'm going to offer for purposes of the record what I've marked as Exhibit 1. I'll provide a copy to Mr. Johnson. And for purposes of the commission, Exhibit 1 is pages 30-39 of your packet. The findings of fact and conclusions of law that the commission had entered. The date of those materials are April 13, 2017. Indicate purposes of the record that would be admitted pursuant to Rule 201 of the South Dakota Rules of Evidence. It's STCL 19-19-201. And those are for purposes of the findings of fact contained within Exhibit 1, adjudicated facts that have been found by the Commission. I'd just like to highlight a handful of those facts. The issue before, that was previously before the Commission, involved a suspected or known cheat, Mr. Haddad, that was in the establishment. As he was escorted out of the establishment, he left chips on the table. There was an issue concerning advising and a dispute concerning advising Mr. Haddad that he continued to have chips on the table. It was a total of $20 in chips on the table between his bet and his tip that had been placed. The commission specifically found that Mr. Johnson did not properly account for those chips and that he did not advise the supervisor of the situation, did not place the chips and account for the chips properly. Johnson, for purposes of the record, on paragraph 33, admitted he made no effort to find out who the player was before taking the chips and putting them in the tip jar. Now, that's a bit of a conclusory statement, but that's the finding in summary of what the commission made. For purposes of 34, or record paragraph 34, exhibit 1 also identifies that Johnson testified on the night of the incident and was acting as a supervisor, claiming there was no one to whom he could report the incident, despite the fact that general manager Austin Burnham was present. In that regard, the commission specifically found Johnson's testimony multiple interaction throughout the investigation with Executive Secretary Elias, where there was an exchange between the $20 that's identified in paragraphs 45 through 48, where Mr. Johnson tried to palm the $20 bill to former Executive Secretary Elias. It was in the exchange after the meeting that occurred to attempt resolution Secretary. Pursuant to paragraph 54 of Exhibit 1, the commission also found the actions of the defendant by taking the chips belonging to the player without placing them in the tip jar without attempting to determine the player's identity constituted dishonest or fraudulent conduct. In paragraph 55, the commission further found that Johnson's statements to the insider, both in the interview as well as the answer to the initial complaint, and the handwritten statement form where Johnson alleged that he repeatedly attempted and yelled to the unidentified player constitutes dishonest or fraudulent conduct, especially when viewed in light of the video evidence and Johnson's testimony. Paragraph 56 of the findings, the commission further found that even if Johnson was acting as a pit supervisor, he offered to report the ability of the best general manager Austin Burnham. And the court had taken the chips to the cage, and therefore did not comply with gaming regulations or the casino's in-house policy. For purposes of applying those adjudicated facts to law, paragraph 6, the commission found that the defendant acted with the chips and got unidentified player, placing them in the tip jar and making no attempt to identify the player constituted grounds for disciplinary action and was a violation of ARSC 20. 1909-2 as an act which constitutes dishonesty or fraudulent conduct. Reference also paragraph 7 of the conclusions of law, finding that the commission finds the defendant's actions in advising Agent Snyder during this interview, as well as in his answer to the commission complaint in the standard statement when he alleged. Wherein he alleged that he repeatedly notified the player that the chips were his. In fact, yelled to the player constitute vows for disciplinary action in violation of the RSC 2018-09-2 as an act which constitutes dishonesty or fraudulent conduct. Particularly when viewed in light of the video surveillance of the incident from the year of September 19, 2016, as well as Johnson's testimony at the hearing. In regard to paragraph 9, I'd also bring the commission's attention to the findings section of Exhibit 1. The SECL section 42-70-61 states The commission may, by rules promulgated pursuant to Chapter 126, provide for the establishment of a list of persons who are to be excluded or ejected from any licensed gaming establishment, including any person whose presence in the establishment is determined to pose a threat to the interests of the state, interests of the state of South Dakota, or to licensed gaming, or both. In making the determination for exclusion, the commission may consider the following: commission finding specifically identifies conduct that would adversely affect public confidence the gaming is conducted on. I know paragraph 10 of the conclusions of law section also identifies the ARST 20-18-08-01-02 states a pertinent part of the criteria to be applied by the commission to prepare a list of persons to be included on the exclusion list, which is the issue before the commission now, are the criteria set forth in SDCL 42-7-61, in that any one of which is sufficient for placement of a person on the list. The commission, in its discretion, may establish evidence of conduct that would adversely affect public confidence and is conducted honest, as that term is used in SDCL subdivision 42-7-61. By any one of the following criteria, and those criteria are, these are the criteria to be applied by the commission today: the person's character, background, past activity is incompatible with the maintenance of public confidence, trust, credibility, integrity, stability, or license gaming. So three, the person's character, background, past activity could create or enhance the risk that their appearance, unsuitable, unfair, or illegal practices, methods or activities of gaming, or the business or financial arrangements, incidental there too, or four, any other factor reasonably related to the maintenance of public confidence in the efficacy of the regulatory process and the integrity of gaming operations in the gaming industry and its employees. Pursuant to paragraph 12 of the conclusions of law, commission specifically finds the defendant's conduct is set forth herein is past activity, which is incompatible with the maintenance of public confidence and trust and credibility and integrity of license game. For purposes of evidence, that's the only evidence I would offer before the commission. For purposes of argument, actually evidentiary purposes, proper procedure at this point would be offer Mr. Chalk an opportunity to present any rebuttal evidence.
Mr. Johnson, do you have any rebuttal?
This is what I have. I have nothing arguing against it.
Did you hear him? Okay.
So.
All right. He said no.
Yeah.
No additional evidence to place in the record on behalf of the commission. Mr. Johnson, you have the opportunity to make a closing statement to the commission.
As I said, this is what happened. And no issues of trying to be dishonest. I wasn't intentionally trying to be. That's all I had to say. I came here to try to get off the exclusion list. It's been 2 years. And I agree. I actually enjoyed being out of this business for a while. It calmed me down. Let me go back to school and let me learn about more of the ethics.
I'm sorry.
And let me learn more about the ethics and appearance of business, actions of businesses. That's all I have to say.
For purposes of argument, I close with the commission. And just identify the statutory and administrative law background for the establishment of the exclusion principle. SCCL 42-7-61 lists out the factors that the commission should consider in determining whether an individual should be placed on the exclusion list. Making the determination for exclusion, the commission may consider any of the following. So paragraph one, which I submit is particularly relevant, is prior conviction of a felony, a misdemeanor involving moral turpitude, or a violation of the gaming laws of any state, the United States, or any of its possessions or territories, including Indian tribes. So three also is implicated by the determination and findings of the commission concerning notorious or unsavory reputation that would adversely affect public confidence and trust in the gaming industry's free from criminal or corruptive influences. Pursuant to the authority 42-7-B-6-1, we also have the administrative rule 2018-08-01-02, which is the criteria for exclusion. The criteria to be applied to the commission to prepare a list of persons. Now, in those factors in determining and providing a little additional guidance as to subparagraph 3 of statutory reference, that rule defines and provides for the commission in its discretion that it may establish evidence of conduct that would be considered to adversely affect public confidence that gaming is conducted honestly, as that terms 427B61 sub 4. And the criteria that fall within that conduct that would affect public confidence involve person's character, background, past activity is incompatible with the maintenance of public confidence, trust, the credibility, integrity, and stability of licensed gaming. The person's character, background, or past activity could reasonably be expected to impair the public perception of confidence in the strict regulatory process created by SCCL Chapter 42-7B and ARST Article 2018. A person's character, background, or past activity could create or enhance a risk of the fact or appearance of unsuitable, unfair, or illegal practices, methods or activities in the conduct of the game, and the process or financial arrangements incidental thereto. Or, sub 4 is the catch-all, any other factor reasonably related to the maintenance of public the efficacy of the regulatory process, the integrity of gaming operations, and the gaming industry as it flows. Now, for purposes of the application of those provisions, findings of this commission, findings of fact and conclusions of law, already established on multiple occasions, there were inaccuracies and untruthful statements made by Mr. Johnson during the investigation of the underlying claim. It also had what I consider both a disrespectful and confrontational exchange with prior executive secretary during their attempt to informally resolve the case. The commission's findings have been affirmed by the Supreme Court. They are the law of the case. They are res judicata. Certainly, acknowledge Mr. Johnson sort of appearing before the commission has had a stand acknowledging these cases, but these are the standards to be applied to the commission. Certainly would fall within the standards for exclusion should the commission determine it was appropriate that have been developed pursuant to the statutory law and the rules of the commission. That would be all I have for statement. That would conclude the contested case that all parties have submitted. Record, and the commission now have the opportunity for questions, should they have them.
Do any of the commissioners have questions? Okay. All right. Dennis and Mike, can you hear us?
Yes.
Okay, good. All right. Okay, not hearing any questions, then I would indicate that the hearing is closed at this time, and we will have an executive session later in our regular business meeting. And at the end of that executive session, we will come out with action regarding this. Okay. All right. The next item is going into our quarterly business meeting. Thank you, Mr. Johnson. Okay, before we adopt our agenda, there are some changes. We will be under on page 2, the stipulation and assurance and voluntary compliance section. It's about 1, 2, 3, the fourth item down. We will be removing the Saloon Gaming Incorporation, Inc., their complaint number 2007-031-RB. And that will be removed on this agenda and taken care of at a later date and time. This was a request by Saloon Gaming. So we will remove that, and those are pages 69 through 77. Then Susan provided us with a new list of the state race officials. There was an adjustment that needed to be made, and those are pages 78, 79, and 82. So that will be a new list, and I will have Susan go through the names and explain that to Dennis and Mike, since you don't have the new list, and we'll explain, have Susan explain kind of what will happen at that point in time. So those are the changes in the agenda for this business meeting. So I would entertain a motion to adopt the agenda.
So moved.
Okay, we have a motion by Carl and Mike Wardeman. You second that?
Yes.
Okay. Is there any further discussion questions? All right. I don't hear any. So all in favor indicate by signifying by aye. Oh, sorry. We'll do a roll call vote since we have a couple people on Zoom. Kathy?
Commissioner Fisher?
Aye.
Commissioner Wardman?
Aye.
Commissioner McFarland?
Aye.
Commissioner Gibbs?
Aye.
Commissioner Wagner?
Aye. Are there any opposition? Motion carried. Okay, the next item is the approval of our minutes for the quarterly meeting of June 16th. Those are pages 42 through 55. This is an action item, so we will need a motion to approve. Does anyone want to make a motion to approve our minutes?
We'll move.
Okay, we have a motion by Dennis McFarland. Do we have a second?
I'll second.
Okay, get second. Okay, can we do our roll call?
Commissioner Fisher?
Aye.
Commissioner Wardman?
Aye.
Commissioner McFarland?
Aye.
Commissioner Gibbs?
Aye.
Commissioner Wagner?
Aye. Okay, all in favor? And okay, so there are no opposition. We have an item of old business that's on our agenda. I don't think we have any old agenda or old business items. Do you have anything, Susan?
No, I do not.
Okay, all right. Okay, our next item is a report from our executive secretary, Susan Christian.
Good morning, Madam Chairman and commissioners. Over the last 6 months, the pandemic has caused a lot of things to change. There's been a lot of changes in the landscape of how the casinos operate and how businesses operate. When I was at the G2E conference in October in Las Vegas, there was some new technology that was out there regarding cashless wagering and electronic table games. With the pandemic, those now have come to the forefront and they're being talked about a lot. And it's because they afford the social distancing. It allows for less contamination of handling of money or handling of cards. So we're seeing a push for some of that to come out there. The cashless wagering that is being proposed and tested out there is a technology that would be an app on your phone, it would be a wallet. A lot of us are familiar with what the wallet is. And it is very similar to an Apple Pay. Some people are familiar with that. It would allow by Bluetooth connectivity for funds to be transferred directly to a gaming device or to a table via the wallet. So we're seeing that being tested out there, and there's a lot of support for that to be a technology that is being adopted by jurisdictions. And so we're keeping an eye on that to see where that goes. Casino revenues nationwide. Most jurisdictions are reporting that they are showing an increase, even though some of the jurisdictions have reduced the number of machines that they have on their floor by about 50%. They're showing revenue numbers and handle numbers that are higher than last year. And they're having fewer patrons, but they're spending more money. Also in the reduction of their slot machines, it has been said on several of the webinars and viral meetings that I've attended that the casinos really, when they had to reduce what was on their floor, took a very close look at what was productive and what wasn't. What machines were being played to an extent that it kept the patron there to play, or were they only playing a few moments and moving away from it? Were there ones that were getting played more? And that maybe they have reduced it and now have a better mix of what's productive on their floors. Here in Deadwood, they've had good casino revenues. They've been higher than last year. June is one of the best, if not the best month since gaming has started. The tax returns and reports were due yesterday. They should be, or I should say, yes, yesterday was the 15th. We should have those stats ready and have them released by Monday. And see, from what we've seen, we're anticipating that they will probably be pretty good. The town was busy. The thing that is not bouncing back, even here in Deadwood, and probably nationwide, is the hospitality industry. That would be your bars, your restaurants, and your hotels, because of the social distancing that they have to do and the means that they have to. They can't have 100% of it open. So that's kind of been a struggle for all of them. October 3rd and 4th, we'll be having our live race meet in Fort Pierre. The horses will start coming in September 28th into the track and the barns. We will start licensing on September 30th. Kathy will be coming to Pierre and I will be there so that we can handle all of that. The Niagara Conference that is going to be in 2021 in Lexington, Kentucky. I have been asked to serve on the organizational board, which I've accepted and sent them my information. We also have had, at the ARCI, we've had Larry has been reappointed as the chairman of the Continued Education and Training. I am have been reappointed to the Paramutual Audit Committee and the Quarter Horse Racing Committee. Mike Shaw has been appointed to the Legal Counsel Committee, and Dr. Cooper has been appointed to serve on the Veterinarian Committee. So that was kind of nice. Those are some accolades. The ACRI, of course, is not a regulatory agency. They are a best practice committee. Right now, we are following through that organization. The U.S. House debate on a bill that will create a national regulatory agency that will oversee all of the regulatory districts. They're optimistic that will come out all right. It's a big task. It's a big job. Probably wouldn't take effect for a couple of years if they were able to get it through. The other item that we are following in D.C. is there is a bill that is being circulated that will make greyhound racing illegal. There's maybe 8 tracks currently nationwide that still offer greyhound. The biggest impact for us, it would impact our OTB in North Sioux City, because they probably get 50%, 60% from Greyhound Racing. Those funds go directly to finance and support the live horse racing. And they're already down 26% over last year. If that happens, that would really cut the amount of funds that would be coming in that would be available for live horse racing. So we're kind of keeping an eye on that just because of the big impact that we'll have just on our state. And that is what I have to report. Do you have any questions?
Does anyone have any questions? of our executive secretary. Okay. Next, we will have comments from our guest. We have our Department of Revenue Secretary Jim Willinger here. So if you would please come on up.
Good morning. Thank you, Madam Chair, for allowing me a few minutes to address the commission. Appreciate that. Before I get started, I would ask that Janelle Bird come up here. One of the fun parts about being the Secretary of Revenue is, you know, on some of our really long-serving employees, we get to congratulate them every year. And with Janelle, my understanding, Janelle started out with South Dakota Retirement System, is that right?
That's correct.
Many years there, then for the Department of Transportation, and then the last 20 plus years with the Commission on Gaming Staff. And just a couple days ago on September 14th is 37 years of service for the state of South Dakota. And so thank you, Janelle.
Here, here.
Wow. For your service with the state, and we appreciate that. Mark's going to give us a little.
Yep, need a picture.
Thank you. So that's, you know, we have many long-serving employees in state government, and we have a lot throughout the Department of Revenue, and so we're blessed to have folks like Janelle that put a lot of time in public service. Before I get started, just going to also wanted to thank Mr. Greg Stroman for his service on the commission, and also welcome Bob Goetz. Thank you to those two folks for their public service, and you all for serving on the commission. Sincerely appreciate that as well. I just want to take a few minutes to give you all an update of a lot of the things that we've been working on kind of department-wide as a department. So Department of Revenue, we have about 250 employees, give or take. And of course, through the pandemic, we're located in many different communities throughout the state. We've been obviously working through all the COVID pandemic situations, as many of us have been. Our leadership team, Susan sits in, we have weekly meetings. We talk about COVID situations every single week. Our employees, the Commission on Gaming employees, have handled things very well. We still have a fair amount of remote workers across the department. Many of our sales and use tax auditors are well prepared to work remotely. And so, you know, we've been handling things well on that front. And so very proud of all of our employees in that instance. The overall revenue picture for the state, just a little bit of an update there. You know, when the pandemic started in March and a lot of businesses closed down for a few weeks, there was a lot of worry that we were really going to take a big hit on the revenue side. But we finished out the fiscal year at the end of June. We were pretty fortunate. We only had one month, and I think it was the month of April, where we actually had a year-over-year decline in our sales tax. All the other months have been positive, so we're still seeing some growth. In fact, the last couple months, the first 2 months of fiscal year 21, we've seen our sales tax in July was up 10.3%, and then in August was up 6.7%. And so through the first couple months of our fiscal year, our sales tax is going pretty strong, up a little over 8%. And even our contractor's excise tax, if you're familiar with that, that's a gross receipts tax based on prime contractors. That through 2 months, that's actually up about 20%. And so we're seeing some pretty good numbers, even considering the pandemic and things like that. And so we're fortunate in South Dakota to have a broad-based sales tax. Some of the other states were seeing double-digit declines early in the pandemic. But most recently, the last couple months, it's actually a nationwide phenomenon. A lot of other states are experiencing pretty decent sales tax growth, and so that's interesting. Of course, some of the special events that we work on, of course, the Sturgis Rally. We have staff that through the sales tax collections, we license all the temporary vendors, the food vendors, and the t-shirt type folks that come in, and we make sure the number of licenses that we issued this year on a temporary basis, they were down, the number were down about 20%, but the collections from those were up about 6%. And so the rally was pretty well attended, as you all probably saw quite a bit of media coverage on that. And so it seemed like people were spending money. And so overall it was a good rally. We adjusted our operations a little bit. Typically we would have all the folks in our Rapid City office come and work the rally, but with COVID concerns, we spread that out a little bit to kind of be on the safe side. We work with the folks in the Sturgis City Hall where we set up an office, and we opened up our electronic payment filing options to all the temporary vendors this year, and many took advantage. So our traffic was down for those folks that come in, and typically they would come in and pay twice throughout the rally. A lot of those folks were able to file and pay electronically, and so that cut down on our foot traffic in light of the pandemic situation. We've been working through our budget process as a department. This month, the governor's budget office, the Bureau of Finance and Management, we have our department budget briefings with them. That's going pretty well thus far. And so we'll work through that budget process until the governor announces her budget proposals, which is early December. And so we've been working through that internally in the department. We're already starting to do preparation for legislative session. As an agency, on an ongoing basis, this happens every year where we will look at the various different divisions and laws to see if there are any tweaks to allow us to gain some efficiencies and things like that. And so we're already reviewing some of those that legislation to put proposals forward for the 2021 legislative session. And then this year, kind of unique, there are a couple of ballot measures on the November ballot. The first one I wanted to mention is Constitutional Amendment A. This constitutional amendment legalizes the possession, use, transportation, and distribution of marijuana and marijuana paraphernalia by people 21 years of age or older. And so this is more on the recreational marijuana front. And so the reason I mention this is the Department of Revenue is the, in that constitutional amendment, if you go read it, is the sole regulatory body of recreational marijuana if that should pass. And so we would be required to issue marijuana-related licenses for commercial cultivators, manufacturers, testing facilities, wholesalers, retailers, and as well as provide for the taxing of marijuana should the voters decide that they want that in South Dakota. And so our staff has been doing a fair amount of research. I think there's about 12 states, I believe, that have recreational marijuana. And then there's also a separate issue, which is initiated Measure 26, that deals with medical marijuana. And there, I think there's a few more than 30 states that have more on the medical side, if you will. So we've been doing research on that. That would be a large change for us as a department. We don't have expertise in regulating marijuana. We've been doing research. The state of Washington, for example, they're one of the early adopters, them in Colorado. The state of Washington's program, they have about 93 full-time employees dedicated and about a $12 million annual operating budget to regulate that program. And so that would be a big change for us. So we're trying to get smarter if that should pass. And so we'll see how what comes of that. The next one is Constitutional Amendment B, which I think many of you are familiar with. So that deals, that would offer an amendment to the Constitution that would authorize the legislature to allow sports wagering in the city of Deadwood. And so that came through as a Senate joint resolution during this last legislative session. So it was passed by both bodies of the legislature, and then it's put on the ballot for a public vote. And so we're doing some preparation for that, should that happen to pass as well, to legalize the sports wagering here in the city of Deadwood. And so that really concludes some of my comments, and I'd certainly be happy to take any questions if anybody has any questions.
Are there any questions? I guess not.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for the time. Appreciate it.
Yes, thank you. Susan, is Frank here?
He's not, Frank. But there are some representatives.
Okay. Susan, do you want to speak to this first, or do you want? I'll just open it. Okay.
Yeah, I think we just open it up.
Kathy, is that okay? Right here. Good morning.
Good morning.
Okay. All right. This is item is in regards to informal request regarding cashless wagering. And we do have representatives. When you speak, you may take your mask off. And I think what we'll do is just start with your comments. And if you could begin by introducing who you are, that would be great. And then we'll probably then have Susan do some, our executive secretary do some comments, and we may have questions.
Okay. I am Kurt Hall, the gaming manager at the Mineral Palace.
Okay.
And what we're here to do is work with you guys to come up with policies and stuff for what we got to do. Is we want to get it to where using our kiosk machine, to where the customer can download money from their accounts to their player's account at the Mineral Palace. Then they're not dealing with cash, they're not carrying cash, they're not worried about it. They can take their player's card, go to the machine, and download the money onto the machine and play it. So they're not handling the cash, they're not dealing with the cash until they're ready to leave. When they're ready to leave, when they're done, they're going to print out a ticket, go to the cage, they can get their money and go. That's pretty much where it is, and I know the regulation doesn't quite allow us to go strictly from their account to their player's account, but that's where we want to get it set up. And then that way they're not handling, they're not coming to town with the cash, they're not dealing with it when they're coming out to gamble.
Do you have comments that you...
No, I don't have any comments unless you guys have comments. I'm Diana Corrado, the general manager at the Mineral Palace.
Okay. Thank you for introducing yourself.
Sure.
Okay. Susan, would you like to reflect on some of the correspondence and things that you sent? Did Frank share our executive
yes.
secretaries? Okay.
Yes.
All right.
And I did meet with Kurt and Diane and regarding the letter and regarding coming here today. The technology that they're asking to use is to be able to, via their Players Club account, to put funds on that Player Club account cash and transfer it back down to the machine. And if they have winnings, then they could transfer it back up to their account. This is the technology that was around in 2009. It didn't really go necessarily anywhere because there are some things that were of concern. One of them is, does it become, are they performing functions of a bank if they're holding that money? Yeah, are they holding it for 3 days? Are they rolling it month to month? Now do they fall under banking regulations? In the letter, it was mentioned that via bank card or credit card. Well, that raises issues of gaming being charged onto a credit card. Is that legal? Is it not legal? Where does that fall in the whole scheme of the things? And we do have rules that we created in 2009. Those rules, if this is something that we did, that we are instructed to go forward with, would have to be completely reevaluated because everything over an 11-year period has changed. We certainly have to become a lot more informed than what we are on how this specific technology would work. And do you guys have anything else you would like to add or any more comments? I'm not quite certain that I understand how it would work from the kiosk. You're saying that rather than interact with the cashier, they'd be able to go to the kiosk directly.
Yes.
And by inserting either a bank card or a credit card into the kiosk,
yep,
they would be able to transfer funds to the Mineral Palace.
Transfer funds.
To the Mineral Palace that would then transform to their account.
Onto their account, yes.
And it would be accessible, not by a smart card.
It would be accessible by their player card.
By their player card. Or they'd be able to print out a wagering voucher, a ticket that could be redeemed in any slot
machine or at the cage.
But you are proposing that it would be via some type of debit card or a credit card.
Correct.
Correct. Okay. I just wanted to clarify that so that I understand what you're asking. And you're also asking that the patron be able to ACH from their bank account into a Mineral Palace bank account.
Correct. Just same as with the credit card, where they go now, if they go to an ATM or cash advance, however they do the credit card, it will go directly to them. So they got to handle the cash and stuff then around the building, where this setup would be to their players club account. That's where the money will wind up at. So then, yes, with their player's card in the machine, then download it to the machine. So they're not physically having to handle and carry the cash. It'll be all done on electronically.
The Mineral Palace would be the custodian of those funds that an individual would put into their account.
Correct.
They would be in your possession. They would not necessarily be there, going to be from a player's account into a Mineral Palace bank account.
They'll be sitting in their player's account.
They will be available through a player's account.
With the same way of what, as we have them plan, and we give them a little bonus back and stuff for the amount of play that they get, which is into their account, tagged to them. Yes, it's still under the umbrella of the Mineral Palace.
Okay. It would be the custodian.
So then, and within that account, that money will be there so they can go to the machines and play. It'll be there if they want to play tomorrow. If they do not take it out, it'll be there next month when they come. Even next year when they come, it will still be in through the player's account.
Okay. This, just for the commissioners, what he's describing is very similar to what Better Racing did. This is an advanced deposit wagering account where the patron gives the money to the, transfers the money to the Mineral Palace that then can be used to play off on the slot machines, just like Better Racing. They gave the money to them and they could then use it to place wagers at different tracks.
Yeah.
That's the concept that he is describing. I don't think I have any other questions. Greg, do you have any questions for him?
No.
And I just, sorry, do you want to
say something? No, go on ahead.
So our kiosk is through Count R, and it's already set up, and we're in the process of researching all the details before when we put in our petition. But it is set up current to be able to do it. We just don't have it turned on. And there's other properties within Deadwood that are looking into the CalNAR system as well. And with all the restrictions of COVID, we just feel that our patrons would be safer.
And in for them to be able to go to their kiosk and currently print out a wagering voucher that would be able to be inserted into a slot machine. That's been out there, and we have rules that regulate that, and they're able to do that. Because it's the same, it falls under our same rules and regulations as the ticket in, ticket out that we have. It's the same.
So what are you asking that basically is different than what is already in place?
What's in place is you got to print it out in a ticket. So okay. I got to carry the ticket. I got to do it. What we're asking is to put it on their account. So now it's everything's electronically done rather than physical done.
Okay.
So you eliminate the cashier.
So eliminating the cashier to be so pretty much because it's all electronically where our staff is not handling your money to get it here, to get it here. It is all done electronically being handled by the customer.
So if I have an account, hate these. Anyhow, if I have an account and I want to come in and play, do I activate the transfer from my account in your casino to the machine at the machine? Or do I have to go to the...
End result is that you can do it. You're the ones going to this kiosk machine to transfer the money from wherever it is you're getting it from to put it here.
Okay. Into your players. Okay.
Then you are the one that's going out to the slot machine and electronically moving it from here to that machine.
Uh-huh.
So it's all electronic. You're the only person involved with transferring your money at that time.
Okay, and if I win, print out a ticket and take it to the cashier.
You can print out the ticket and take it to the cashier. You can pull your card. The money can upload back into your account. So you can go to another slot machine, put in your card, and download there. And you do not have to handle the tickets. The only time the ticket is be handled is right at the end, before you go home, if you so choose to take that cash with you.
Mm-hmm.
That's the only time that you're going to be handling the money.
Do the casinos in Deadwood have this type of machines on their floors now?
We do.
You do.
We do. And there's another one in the Franklin. And there's another one set to come into the Silverado as soon as the federal governments will let stuff get shipped in from where they're at.
Okay. So you have to get a special kind of a machine that's wired for this.
You got to have the machine that's already set with the software capability of handling it.
Sure.
Right now, the ticket redemption machines in town outside of these, all they can pretty much handle is redeeming your ticket or breaking down your bill to smaller cash if you want to put in 100 and tens and fives, whatever. But you got to play with the money. You got to handle the money. That's where we're getting away from is to where.
So basically you are kind of like a savings account until I want to come in and spend my money.
I guess you can call it that way.
Yeah.
You know.
Okay.
Did you have a question?
Yeah. Along those lines, since you'd be basically the custodian, do you have a policy or procedure that you thought of as far as dormant accounts? Where would, you know, after a period of time, if you have unused funds, where would that end up?
You know, for right now, we're not looking so much as a dormant. If it is going dormant, we can, within the regulations of what you guys come down with and stuff, and we can set it up to where, okay, in the Players Club, we got your address. We got your phone number, unless you move and never change it with us or change phones and never told us or whatever, that we can turn around and get a hold of you and say, hey, you got $50, you got $500, whatever it is. and we can send it off to you if you no longer come in. Right now, if somebody passes away, it will wind up going back to the family, usually between husband and wife, kids and husband. So we know who in the heck people are, you know, so we'll get them back their money instead of just, it just doesn't delete and go into our pocket.
Okay. Did anyone else have any questions? Because I do think there are a couple of things. First of all, we would need a specific request to petition for the rule changes, which is, I understand Susan's letter to you that right. has not happened. So I guess at this point, you know, this is more for the discussion and information. Correct. And I guess if that's your intent, that you intend to petition the commission for the rule changes and things, that would probably need to be the first next step. And I guess probably then we would probably want to have our staff look at doing, you know, some specific research to address some of the issues. I think Commissioner Getz's point was a very good point, that's something that we would definitely want to make sure that the casinos were able to deal with that, the delinquent accounts. That's just one example. So, I guess, in my understanding, that's the first next step, that they would need to specifically make that request to the commission for the to petition the rule change. And then we can see where we want to go from that point forward.
Okay.
But this is good information, and obviously based on our executive secretary's report, you know, these are issues that are surfacing with the cashless wagering due to the COVID. So does anyone have any other questions? Dennis or Mike?
I just have one. Mike, go ahead, Mike, if you have a question.
Go ahead, Dennis.
How many cashiers are currently employed at the Mineral Palace?
Five.
Did you hear that? He said five.
Okay. How many would be employed if this were adopted the way you envision it?
Five.
Would continue to be employed?
Yeah.
They would still need them, Dennis, is what he's saying.
They
would still need the same number.
Well, would they be doing anything differently than they do now?
No, it'd still be there because you're still going to have people that are still going to carry in their own money and they're still going to need the cashier. The cashier is still going to be needed at the end result if you so choose you want to take your money with you. So we're not looking to eliminate staff because of this. We're looking more or less to where we are not handling physically the money as much as what, and the customer's not handling the money.
Okay. Providing an additional service.
Okay. They're looking at it as an additional service and not eliminating staffing because they're looking at the fact that they will still have people that will handle cash and bring cash in. So I don't, does that answer what you were asking, Dennis?
Well, I'm trying to figure out what the advantage is and to whom. Does that mean that we assume if this convenience is there that more people will spend more money or that it will make the casino more profitable? What's the end game?
One, it's more the convenience to the user so they're not playing with it. Two, if it gets you to have more money accessible to you to play, in the long run, the casino would hopefully make some more money off the deal. And if we make more money, you guys wind up making more money off of what we do.
We have a lot of patrons that come in and some you can tell they don't necessarily want to carry all that cash with them. Same goes when you fly to Vegas, you don't necessarily want to carry all the cash with you when you go on a public airplane.
Anything else, Dennis?
Not right now.
Okay. Mike, did you have a question?
Yeah, I did. Anytime you take the human element out of handling money, a person will gamble more. And for problem gamblers, they need that break. And they need a little time in between. So just to hand somebody a credit card is almost a blank check approach to a line of credit at a table.
Correct.
And we understand that as well.
Their response was that they understand that as well. And I think that is a very valid concern, Commissioner Wardaman. Any other questions? This is an information item, so.
I think you're going to need the cashiers no matter what, because everybody isn't going to belong to the Players Club or whatever it is and have an account, you know.
Correct.
And I think, yeah, they recognize that. But I guess right now the first step is that there is a process by our rules and regulations that needs to be followed. And at this point in time, that hasn't happened. So if this is what your intent is, then you would need to go back and make that petition for the rule changes.
Right. To work with our executive secretary.
Right.
Correct.
Well, all of us. I mean, if, yes. Then we would need to decide if we want to address it. And if so, more than likely, I would recommend that we would have our staff do some fairly significant research on things that we would need to consider.
Do casinos and most other gambling jurisdictions do this now, like Vegas and Colorado and those?
Moving towards it.
Pardon?
They're moving towards it.
Okay.
I think, Commissioner Fisher, one of the holdups and the pushbacks were the financial institutions didn't want that to happen. But with COVID, that has changed. But the financial institutions did not want it placed on credit cards, didn't want them to use a debit card. And they were not supporting that back in 2009. And it has never really gone anywhere just because of that. There was significant pushback. And so I don't know if there still is. They're moving forward with this other avenue and yet let this what they're proposing is an older technology. The new technology that they're now trying to get involves the wallet on a mobile app.
Right. Okay, any other discussion? All right, if not, I guess we'll move on. Thank you, Kurt and Diane, for coming in.
Thank you for listening.
Have a great day.
Yes.
Thank you, Susan.
Okay, our next item is the stipulation of assurance and voluntary compliance. The one that we will need to address is the Rocky Ladson support license number A4510-00-SP, and it's complaint number 2005-023-MH. Okay, and basically, Susan, do you want to go ahead and explain what you have done and explain the process?
On June 9th, Agent Hessel filed an initial complaint regarding some activity that he had observed through video surveillance reviews that he had done in May. And Mr. Latson had cashed out tickets. Credits were left on a machine, abandoned on a machine. Mr. Latson was observed cashing these tickets out of the machine, printing a ticket, and then he was also the cashier. So he was redeeming the money and keeping it for his own personal use. And that violates our entitlement to slot machine credits. 2018-1201-0701 that specifically states that if credits are abandoned on the machine, a ticket is printed out and turned into the cashier, and they try to find the owner of the credits. And if they cannot, then it is taken into accounting and voided out. That was not what Mr. Latson was doing. So we filed the initial complaint, and he came and we did an informal consultation with him. And the value of the tickets was $21. So I went back and looked at how the past, what we had done with those tickets. And we haven't had this for quite a number of years. There were two instances where an initial complaint was filed and a resolution was reached between the executive secretary and the licensee. In both instances, the licensees were required to surrender their license for 7 days. And one was assessed a fine of $25. The other one was not, but that individual had lost his job. He was terminated. So in keeping with what we had done with the past, I offered, and Mr. Latson accepted, a $25 fine and a suspension of his gaming license for 7 days. He surrendered it. He was to pay the fine when he came back in and picked his license up. He complied. He paid the $25, which is more than what we valued the tickets at. So he really had no monetary gain. He cashed out $21 and we fined him $25. So he really didn't. I thought that was probably pretty fair. He had no gain whatsoever of it. And I am asking that you just ratify this and accept this.
Okay. So we will need action to ratify our executive secretary's decision with this. So
moved.
Have a motion.
Second.
Have a second. Any discussion? Okay, I don't hear any, so we'll go ahead with our roll call vote.
Commissioner Fisher?
Aye.
Commissioner Worthen?
Aye.
Commissioner McFarland?
Aye.
Commissioner Getz?
Aye.
Commissioner Wagner?
Aye. Motion carries. Okay, now we are into our next item, which relates to our horse racing matters. Executive Secretary Christians gave a new list of the state race officials and the track officials for the benefit of Commissioners Wardeman and McFarland. Would you go through these, the changes? And once those are completed, we can make a motion to act on these officials. We can do both of them in one motion.
Doug Runge was incorrectly identified to me as a state official. And I didn't catch it because he was not listed on the association's list that was submitted to me for approval. And so he needs to be removed from page 78. He's not a state steward. He's the association steward. And so he comes back in on page 79 and 80 is where he improved.
Okay. So basically you removed him from page 78 and moved him then to the track race officials where he belongs.
79.
That is correct.
Right. Okay. Does that make sense to our commissioners that are via Zoom?
Good for me.
Okay. All right, then we need a motion, please, to approve these officials. I have a motion. All right, you can pick. I believe, yes, Commissioner Getz made a motion. I think Commissioner McFarland seconded. Any further discussion? All right, let's then do our roll call vote.
Commissioner Fisher?
Aye.
Commissioner Wardman?
Aye.
Commissioner McFarland?
Aye.
Commissioner Getz?
Aye.
Commissioner Wagner.
Aye. Okay, our next group of contracts are the three, the veterinary service services by the Cooper Animal Clinic, the lab testing center for tax services, and the enforcement services with the Stanley County Sheriff's Department. These are all contractual items that we would need to approve.
I do.
Pardon me?
I would move to approve the contract.
Okay, thank you, Commissioner Waterman. I have a motion to approve. Do I have a second?
Second.
A second by Commissioner Fisher. Is there any discussion? It's pretty straightforward, right? Yes. Okay, let's do our roll call vote for approval.
Commissioner Fisher?
Aye.
Commissioner Waterman?
Aye.
Commissioner McFarland?
Aye.
Commissioner Getz?
Aye.
Commissioner Wagner?
Aye. Motion carries. Now we have our Deadwood licensing matters. There will be four different matters that we need to approve, and Craig will take us through the approvals or denials.
Thank you, Chairman. Since the last commission meeting, staff has completed a number of backgrounds, and staff recommend key license approvals for Tyler Nold, Kenneth Elliott, Todd Corkins, Bruce Stairs, Talia Galagos, Susan Keitlinger, and Ashley Schubauer.
And we would need a motion to approve these. May I have a
move?
Okay. Commissioner McFarland made a motion to approve. Do I have a second?
Mm-hmm. We're good.
Okay.
I'll second.
Okay. Commissioner Getz will second. All right. Any discussion? All right. If not, go ahead with our roll call.
Commissioner Fisher?
Aye.
Commissioner Waterman?
Aye.
Commissioner McFarland?
Aye.
Commissioner Getz?
Aye.
Commissioner Wagner?
Aye. Motion carries. Okay.
Staff would now recommend denial of a key license for Heather Herman. The short to that is that she just didn't finish the process and she's no longer working in the Deadwood.
All right. We will need a motion for the denial of this one.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Commissioner Fisher moved and Commissioner Getz second. Let's go ahead with any discussion. All right, go ahead with the roll call.
Commissioner Fisher?
Aye.
Commissioner Waterman?
Aye.
Commissioner McFarland?
Aye.
Commissioner Getz?
Aye.
Commissioner Wagner?
Aye. Motion carries.
Okay. Staff would recommend approval of Novomatic AG as the owner of a manufacturer's license and following individuals listed as owners or directors. Johannes Graf, Johannes Gratzel, Reisard Persch, and Birgit Wimmer. Staff would also recommend a business license renewal, retail license for Pat and Annie Roberts.
Okay, we need a motion for these approvals and renewals.
So moved.
Okay, we have a motion by Commissioner Fisher and a second by Commissioner Getz. Any discussion? All right, let's go ahead with our roll call vote.
Commissioner Fisher?
Aye.
Commissioner Waterman?
Aye.
Commissioner McFarland?
Aye.
Commissioner Getz?
Aye.
Commissioner Wagner?
Aye. Motion carries. Thank you.
And the last staff would ask that you ratify the licensing actions of the executive secretary per 42-7B-11, parent 16, with the approval of the key license for Karen Barthel.
Move approval.
Okay. We have a motion. Was that McFarland or?
Waterman.
Waterman, thank you very much. Do I have a second?
Second.
Okay, Commissioner Fisher seconded. Discussion? All right, let's have our roll call vote, please.
Commissioner Fisher?
Aye.
Commissioner Waterman?
Aye.
Commissioner McFarland?
Aye.
Commissioner Getz?
Aye.
Commissioner Wagner?
Aye. Motion carries. Okay. We need to confirm, is December 16th still a good date for our next meeting? That date
sounds good to me.
Works for me also.
Fine.
Okay. And that'll work for you. Okay. It, Looks as though the 16th will work for everyone, so that will be our next.
16th or 15th?
16th.
16th, okay.
We had both down as an either or, but we're going with the 16th. So if you have the 15th on your calendar, take it off, please. All right. Now, do we have any public comments?
Madam Chairman, just for the record, because of the arrangement, I checked out of the hall. There's somebody out of the hall waiting.
Okay, thank you.
No, but there may be somebody on the phone.
Is there anyone on the phone that has any?
Dennis Rodman from the DGA was going to call in and speak briefly. Dennis, are you on the line?
Mike.
Oh, Mike. What did I say, Dennis Rodman, the basketball player? Oh, hi. Or Mike. Dennis, Mike. Mike, are you on the line? I don't know.
Mike Rodman, are you on the line? Anyone that is telephonically connected, do you have any public comments?
They may be muted. They can unmute themselves.
You can unmute your phone or unmute yourself if you do have comments. They all are, but I think we're okay.
Okay.
All right. Now I will need a motion to enter into executive session.
So moved.
Second.
All right. We have a motion and a second, so we'll do a roll call.
Commissioner Fisher?
Aye.
Commissioner Boardman?
Aye.
Commissioner McFarland? Commissioner Getz?
Aye.
Commissioner Wagner?
Aye. Okay, how do we keep?
I need to set up a breakout room for the executive session. Commissioners Boardman and McFarland, you'll have a question that asks you to join the session, and then when it finishes, you'll have one to rejoin the main meeting, okay?
Okay.
Don't forget to mute everything that you know this well.
Right, yeah. We had a issue for a different group
where
we had
a reporter refused to get off the line.
Yeah.
Don't we have
yeah.
Well, we can't. They need to hear us.
Yeah, those two do. But we have to make sure that, just like we did with our guest, Karen, that everything was muted so that they can't hear you.
Yeah, I know. But.
And I think that it was Phil's that we had to mute.
Okay.
It was just a reminder.
Do I need to click join, Phil?
Yeah, did you get a message?
I did.
Yes, please join that computer.
Okay, can you hear me now?
I can hear you.
Okay, all right. I've called us out of executive session and we will have an action item.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
I would move that we deny the petition for the appeal.
Of Charles Johnson?
Of Charles Johnson.
Okay, do I have a second?
Second.
Okay, Commissioner Fisher seconded. Do we have further discussion? All right, let's do roll call, please.
Commissioner Fisher?
Aye.
Commissioner Boardman?
Aye.
Commissioner McFarland?
Aye.
Commissioner Getz?
Aye.
Commissioner Wagner?
Aye. Okay, thank you. There are not any other items on the agenda, so I would have request a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Boardman?
Second.
Second, Commissioner Getz. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Well, we better do our roll call, I suppose. Kathy?
Commissioner Fisher?
Aye.
Commissioner Boardman?
Aye.
Commissioner McFarland?
Aye.
Commissioner Getz?
Aye.
Commissioner Wagner?
Aye. Motion carries. Thank you.